Next on Enviro Close Up, industrial hemp. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I'm Carl Grossman. Industrial hemp is the focus of a new award-winning documentary, Bringing It Home. And with us is the producer and director of Bringing It Home, Linda Booker. Welcome, Linda.
Thank you, Carl. Thank you for inviting me here today.
Linda, what is Bringing It Home about?
So Bringing It Home is about industrial hemp, healthy houses, and a greener future for America. We went on a worldwide journey to talk about how hemp is being used around the world for textiles, food, building, construction, and we really discovered that this is a story that needs to be told. A lot of Americans, I think, have a lot of misconceptions or misunderstandings about the hemp plant, and of course, we have a policy that currently exists that's prohibiting our American farmers from growing it, despite the fact that 31 other industrialized nations are farming hemp all over the world.
And as you point out, hemp has been grown for thousands of years all over the world. But in this country, in the United States, no hemp growing allowed. I mean, it's prohibited. What, maybe, and who is behind that prohibition?
Well, first I want to say that there's good news. There's been a tremendous amount of legislative policy and action that's happened just within the last year. And with the latest farm bill, the U.S. government is finally allowing a few research pilot programs to go forward, only in states that have already passed some legislation for hemp farming. And right now, currently, that number is at 13 states. So that was really an amazing thing that happened just within the last few months. But there still exists the federal policy of industrial hemp being labeled as a Substance 1 narcotic. So this still is really the major barrier to a hemp industry in the United States right now. So even though we have some research going on with state agricultural departments and through universities beginning this year, nothing really is going to move forward until the federal policy changes around hemp.
The 800-pound gorilla, so to speak, in connection with hemp is the perceived connection between hemp and marijuana. Address that.
So we address this through animation in our film, and we really wanted to do something that was kind of fun and interesting and educational to view. And so in our animation, we use the example that hemp and marijuana are like poodles and wolves in the canine species. Both marijuana and industrial hemp are underneath the cannabis sativa L plant family, species of plants. However, they are different varieties and they're very different in structure and use. But the main difference is that with marijuana, you have a very high THC level, THC being the psychoactive chemical that gives you that high, and industrial hemp is incredibly low in THC. So there's no chance that you can use industrial hemp for any drug purposes or getting high whatsoever.
Could you use the marijuana plant, that species, for hemp too?
Really, they are different in that industrial hemp has specifically been developed. The varieties have been developed for fiber and for that seed and oil use. And we know, and marijuana is strains have been developed for flowers and buds, so for medicinal or, drug use. So really, you do have two different uses for the two different members of that plant family.
We're talking to Linda Booker, producer and director of an award-winning documentary, Bringing It Home, about industrial hemp. Now, the key federal law is the 1970 Federal Controlled Substances Act, which covers hemp. Now, does the prohibition against hemp precede that, or was that the big piece of legislation that bars hemp from being grown?
Well, that really defined it as a drug, and so really put up the biggest wall and barriers for anybody wanting to grow it. I mean, you could apply for a DEA permit, but only four ever got even allowed or were permitted since the 1970s Controlled Substance Act. Prior to that, there certainly is a history in the United States of the conflation of marijuana and hemp, which started to really, in the public mind and in the media, connect them as one and the same, and that, you know, hemp is, you know, bad for children, and, you know, really throwing them together as the same thing. Up until then, we had a very thriving hemp industry through the turn of the century, because all our textiles were being made from that, all the canvases on boats and rope. And then during World War II, we had a resurgence in the farming of hemp because there was a shortage of ropes for the Navy ships. And so we have the U.S. government at this time during the 1940s really encouraging farmers in Kentucky and throughout up to through Wisconsin to be growing it, even encouraging boys and girls in the 4-H clubs to plant hemp seeds. So we kind of point out this ironic flip-flop policy in the film that, you know, somehow through our history, hemp is good, hemp is bad, you know. But what we really know is that hemp is good for us, I mean, in so many ways.
Well, enumerate the ways. I mean, the film is about, well, biofuel you speak about, and food and beverages. Let's go through some of the uses of hemp beyond rope. I mean, people, I think, are probably familiar with hemp as a material to make rope with.
Right. That's usually the first thing a lot of people will connect it with, or like they'll say, this is another one we hear a lot, yeah, I bought a hemp t-shirt, you know, like 20 years ago, and I tried to smoke it. I mean, everybody likes to make some jokes about, you know, and that's fine. I think, I heard one of the hemp advocates say something that was kind of interesting, that a lot of the jokes get made still about hemp and marijuana being the same thing, but now at least when somebody's making the joke, they usually pretty know that they're really not. They know that they're really not. And so they'll be like, yeah, we're just kidding. We know that industrial hemp and marijuana are two different plants. But getting back to your question about the uses, so I really kind of want to start with how this film started to kind of walk through that. My friend Blair Johnson and I, who are the co-directors on this project, we met at the Center for Documentary Studies at Duke University back in 2003, and she had read Jack Herer's book, The Emperor Wears No Clothes, which talks about how, you know, the hemp industry pretty much was, you know, died out because of several reasons, you know, whether it was, you know, corporate entities involved or, you know, the Hearst Corporation. He walks through a lot of different reasonings why the hemp industry diminished in the United States. And she just was really passionate about, you know, there needed to be a documentary film that to help re-educate Americans about this incredibly beneficial plant. And I would listen, you know, and say, yes, that sounds good, but it wasn't really something that was engaging me. And certainly you don't want to get involved in a big film project unless it's something, you know, your fire needs to be lit a little bit about it. You know you're going to be, if you're going to do a major project like we did, which takes 2.5 years, and you know you're going to want to do film festivals, and you know you're going to want to do a grassroots campaign, you better be committed. And I wasn't quite there yet, but I happened to buy a coffee one day back in the fall of 2010 and picked up a USA Today, not a paper I normally even buy, but I picked it up and I turned to page 3 and there was this big story about the nation's first hemp house being built. And it had been completed in Asheville, North Carolina, which is our home state. And that kind of intrigued me. I'm like, oh, that's pretty cool. You know, we've got the, as Blair likes to say, we were first in flight and first in hemp house so, in our state. But it was the story of the designer that kind of drew me in. As a filmmaker, it's always really, if you can find a personal story that helps with the connectivity on a personal level of an issue, that's always very helpful. And with Anthony Brenner, he was looking for a sustainable, non-toxic, healthy building solution for his young daughter, had a lot of chemical sensitivities, and he wanted to actually build a company around building healthy houses. So almost amazingly at the same time, this company called Hemp Technologies had just got going in Asheville. And so literally down the street pretty much is the answer for him. He finds out about Hemp Technologies, finds out about hempcrete being the most amazing, non-toxic, chemical-free building material that's been used in Europe for 30 years, and this gets him very excited. So what he ends up doing is he ends up pitching this to his clients, who happened to be the former mayor of Asheville and his wife, and they built with Hemp Technologies a beautiful, modern-looking hempcrete house. It looks, as it's been said, looks like it's out of the pages of Dwell. So that was sort of like the story that we thought, hey, let's do a short documentary film on this. And it ended up just becoming, just the beginning. So we talk a lot about hemp construction and hemp building in the film.
It's not, sticks of hemp with which the house is built. It's hempcrete. Can you elaborate on what hempcrete is?
So hempcrete is a mixture of the hemp shiv, which is the inner woody fiber core of the hemp stalk, with lime, a lime binder, and water. One of the interviews that I really love is we got an opportunity to speak with Kevin MacLeod, who is the host of Grand Designs in Great Britain. And he had actually chosen with his business partner to do a hempcrete housing development project in Swindon, UK. And I love his description of hempcrete. He's like, it's just like this light, fluffy cement, and it's really, great to work with, and there's not all these bundles of wires everywhere around, and the construction workers liked it. And, it just was so cool that they grew the hemp, just within 150 miles and used it to build those houses with, and that hemp was absorbing toxins and pollution out of the air and then being made into something that was continuing to be beneficial for the environment.
Other uses of hemp, biodegradable plastic.
Yeah, so hemp composites or biocomposites are really, I think, a wide open field. And there are, I know Germany is one country that's doing a lot of research around hemp plastics. And certainly we do have products out there. We show a hemp briefcase and in our film, and there's hemp surfboards now and skateboards. And, there's really a lot of potential for that. There's been some auto prototypes that had hemp exterior bodies. But what does exist now is that we have hemp fiber, and a lot of car companies are using it, especially in Europe. So you've got Mercedes, BMW, Audi, Chrysler, GM have all used industrial hemp in their door panels and in their dashboards of cars. So, we talk about what are the potential possibilities for the building a hemp industry in the United States. And I keep thinking, oh my gosh, just look at building and retrofitting, first of all. I mean, that could be a really big market here. And the auto industry. I mean, we have a history with Henry Ford actually doing a prototype back in the mid-40s using hemp as part of a biocomposite plastic in a prototype car. So they have a history of their founder, working with hemp with automobiles, and I just think, what a beautiful story it would be now for them to say, let's help American farmers, let's help change our policy here so that we can, make environmentally friendly automobiles using the hemp plant that's grown here in America.
And one of the points you also make, pesticides are not needed somehow,
right,
in the growing of hemp. What is the special ingredient that hemp provides, whether it's building material or plastic? I mean, there must be something notable about hemp that allows it to be so good in these products.
So it's one of the strongest plant fibers that exists. So that's why when you're talking about biocomposites and strength and durability, combined with the lightness of using that, that's, I think, is what's a beneficial aspect of it. For building, apparently the fiber structure, again, is really interesting. And of course, I'm not... not a scientist but we did interview a researcher at the University of Bath who had done a research with using it. They built a hemp pod construction structure at the University of Bath, and they wired up the walls with all these sensors so that they can monitor thermal regulation and humidity regulation. And what they found out was that there's something about the cell structure in the hemp plant that enables these walls to breathe and insulate at the same time. And so it's just this amazing building material. And in addition to that, the hempcrete products are mold and mildew resistant, fire retardant, pest resistant. And so you have a structure that literally, you know, uses hardly any heating or cooling system to regulate the temperature, in addition to all these amazing benefits. And it can be recycled. And they estimate the longevity of hempcrete to be, you know, 500 years plus, so, which is longer than any of you and I are going to be around. So, I mean, I think that's incredible. When we went to England to do some location filming, we visited a brewery distribution warehouse, Southwold Brewery, and they did this incredible green eco building. They actually built the hempcrete blocks right there on site. And, you know, we had the CEO of their company saying, we don't have to use any heating or cooling to regulate the temperature in this building. And the same went story was with the wine distribution warehouse there. And then just recently, Marks and Spencer, which is a major department store chain, they chose a hempcrete panel system for their construction of a flagship store in England. So you've got these incredible large-scale projects going on over there.
You can drink and you can eat hemp. I mean, not as hempcrete, but in other forms. Talk about that.
Sure. Well, I think that's another really exciting sector of what the potential for hemp can do for our bodies and for our health. And certainly co-ops and stores like Whole Foods are seeing the sales of hemp products really increase in the last few years as we're seeing hemp seeds and hemp milk show up on superfood lists, and Dr. Oz is talking about it, and you've got a lot of the nutritionists like Ashley Koff touting its benefits and Andrew Weil. So that's really created a huge amount of awareness around what a great food product it can be. It's a great protein source, especially I don't eat a lot of meat, so I'm you know, always concerned about my protein intake, and hemp protein is a great way to get some really good plant protein in you that's high in fatty acids, omega-3s and 6s, and all kinds of good minerals. And you're just thinking, wow, this is just, you know, from this plant that can also do all these other things.
Paper, I mean, as an alternative to cutting down forests, cutting down trees, I mean, there is hemp that could be used for paper.
Absolutely. Exactly. You know, it's kind of a no-brainer, and we hear this term a lot, that with all these uses, it's just astounding that we're really not taking advantage of it more. And we know that the carbon absorption through even just the plant itself is 4 times higher than woodlands or forests, so that you've got, you know, multiple benefits around it. And it's a fast-growing plant. I mean, you're talking about for paper or for construction, a crop that will grow in 90 to, I guess, 120 days versus, you know, what, 15, 20 years for mature trees. So it's just such a difference. And then if you combine that with the carbon absorption rate, I mean, you're talking about something that obviously is not going to solve, you know, all our issues around, you know, some global warming, you know, but it's certainly something that I think has a potential to be a piece of a part of a solution of many things that can be so good.
And then hemp for clothing, and you're wearing.
Yes, I am.
Hemp, speak about what you're wearing made of hemp.
Sure.
I mean, you wouldn't know it.
Yeah. Well, this is what I think a lot of people aren't aware of, is that there's some beautiful hemp fabrics now. I mean, really anything you can think of, from denims to silk. And I happen to be wearing a sweater. This is by Braintree, which is a company in England that we filmed in their store in London. And you can, I mean, they're online like every store is now. They do a beautiful collection of hemp and cotton organic fabrics. And this is from, the shirt is from Vital Hemp, and this is a company that's based out in California, and they do, again, you know, really good looking hemp shirts for women and men. There's a lot of eco couture designers now, very excited about hemp fabrics. I wish I had a picture of the dress that I wore at our Los Angeles premiere. It was just a gorgeous hemp silk cocktail dress. So, hemp's not just burlappy or, it can be everything. And we show that in the film. We have a lovely clothing designer from Greensboro, North Carolina, Stephanie Teague, and her business is called Pretty Birdie. And she's done some beautiful, beautiful clothes with it.
And you use the line, hemp is hope.
Yes.
Talk about that.
Sure. Well, it's, for me, I sometimes get frustrated. I think like a lot of people do when we're frustrated and sad and disheartened around so, it's hard, addressing some of our environmental issues. I mean, it's a lot of overload when we're talking about fracking and pollution and coal mining and, fossil fuel use. And it's just sort of like, oh my gosh, it's really weighs so heavy. And
don't leave out nuclear.
And nuclear power. Sure.
Wow.
Again, there's so much of it. And I think with hemp, it's not that it can solve all these issues, but it's just something that's so easy that we can be doing, that offers so many possibilities to either replace petrochemical products or to replace, synthetic products and do good things for our environment, help our farmers out with weed control and soil, remediation and soil health, and, build homes that are healthy indoor environments that are, benefiting our environment. It's just, the list goes on and on and on. And so, me, who is normally really not, if you knew me, you would say, Linda's not walking around like, with rose-colored glasses. I mean, I try to really look at things with, a pragmatic eye. And that's why I had to research it myself and really kind of, find out on my own journey, too, that this really was something that, why didn't I know about this? Why don't more people understand that this is something we should legalize here, that we should be growing? And so for me as the filmmaker, I wanted to make really a documentary that appealed to a broad audience. And so I'm really proud of the film festival awards that we've received and really happy that this film has been able to reach legislators and all kinds of people across the country.
There's some hypocrisy in terms of the U.S. stand on hemp. I mean, we don't allow farmers to grow it, nevertheless, we allow the importation of hemp, and you point that out from England, from Canada, and from other countries, and a variety of products are made with hemp in this country. I mean, that's kind of strange, no?
Oh, it really is. I mean, that's the perplexing part of it, is that this ironic policy we have. And, I like to tell people that, here our Declaration of Independence was drafted on hemp paper. Well, how independent are we if we have to import hemp from, like, Great Britain if we want to build a house, a hempcrete house here? I mean, they're growing it in England and they're growing it in Canada. And America is the largest importer of hemp products right now. And China is the largest exporter. So, if nothing else, I kind of like to stoke the American spirit sometimes, like, come on, we need to catch up with this. Why aren't we doing this?
The Industrial Hemp Act of 2013 that was seen as, well, maybe the way towards legalized hemp growing in this country. But what are the politics today on that issue? Are we going to get that legalization?
Boy, I sure hope so. Like I think I stated earlier, it's been an amazing last few years as far as hemp legislation being introduced or passing. And I would say for anybody who really wants to get in to look to see, the specifics of this, they need to go to votehemp.com. That's an amazing resource, not only to find out what is happening state to state as far around legislative policy, but also how can you take action? What can you do? I mean, who do you need to write to? Who do you need to, what letter can you sign to support it either in your state or also the federal policy change? So the Industrial Hemp Farming Act that you mentioned is still active, and they are still trying very hard to get more co-sponsors to sign on to that. And there's actually a national awareness campaign called Hemp History Week, and that's one of the big incentives, is to get people to write, call, email, do whatever you can to your state legislators, and let's get this bill passed once and for all.
And broadly, what can people do? You talk about the website, but essentially, what does the website suggest?
That kind of action, I think, and education. A lot of legislators still need educating. The general public still needs educating. That's one of the things I've been happy about. I think our film has been able to make a dent in that a little bit. It's getting more co-sponsors for the Industrial Hemp Farming Acts and finally getting it to the point where it can get, you know, a vote. So the Industrial Hemp Farming Act would redefine industrial hemp as and take it out of that substance one narcotic definition. It would just redefine it as a plant that has 0.3% of tetrahydrocannabinol, the THC, or less. And that's pretty much what's standard in the countries where we visited, in Canada and the UK. They test it, they regulate it. There's models that are very successful in other countries that certainly the United States can be doing. And it has started here. So I do want to say again, things are moving along, but the biggest prohibitor is still the federal law that's prohibiting any viable seed from being imported into the United States or being, you know, prohibiting, you know, states from moving it from across straight lines. Colorado is the one state that's gone ahead and allowed their farmers to grow hemp. The very first industrial hemp crop since 1957 was harvested in Colorado last summer by a farmer named Ryan Laughlin, and I think he's definitely applying again to grow more acres this year, and I know other farmers in Colorado have registered. But they are still putting themselves at risk because the DEA still considers it a drug.
And the feds might go after them.
They could if they want to. Now, it seems like there's sort of a bit of a let's wait and see policy right now, kind of the way they're looking at the marijuana industry in Colorado. They did set forth some criteria that they've sort of want to see met around both of those the industries, and certainly is more around medical marijuana than the hemp plant since it's not a drug. Basically, these farmers are still at risk for losing bank loans, subsidies, insurance. So it really just still is, it's just still not there yet.
I know you stressed the difference between marijuana and hemp, but would the legalization of marijuana in Colorado and other states in the country just in recent years help in the legalization of hemp growing?
Well, in those states, because I think because of just they were able to put it all into one bill. And so when they passed their medical marijuana bill, they also included language around the hemp industry and allowing that to move forward as well. Now, that's not the case in all states. Some states are treating it as a separate policy. And so in Kentucky or Tennessee or Hawaii, they're merely passing industrial hemp bills.
Thank you, Linda Booker, for being with us and telling us, well, more than I've known about hemp. You and the documentary, great educational sources on industrial hemp. I am Carl Grossman. Thanks for watching. For more information on this or any Enviro Close-Up program, just visit our website, EnviroVideo.com.